This is Whitley Strieber, and this is Dreamland. You've reached the edge of the world.
Welcome back to Dreamland. I'm your new guest host, Kelly Chase. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month, filling in for Whitley. And if you're interested in checking out any of my other work, you can find it on my own podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole, which is available wherever you listen to podcasts. I have a great guest for you today. I had the pleasure of sitting down with one of my friends, Darren King, aka Exoacademian. Darren is a phenomenal researcher and communicator in the fields of ufology and consciousness studies. Darren is the host of the Point of Convergence podcast, the co-host of the Liminal Frames podcast. He's also currently serving as the Director of Development and Communications for the John Emack Institute. Darren also offers classes, retreats, and coaching through his website, Essence of Being, on topics related to expanding consciousness. If you're interested in learning more about Darren, I will have all of that linked up in the episode description. So without further ado, here's my guest, Darren King. Well, hey, Darren, welcome to the show. It's so great to see you.
You as well, Kelly. Happy to be here.
Awesome. Well, I've been so excited to talk to you. You were one of the very first, I think maybe the very first interview that I did in this field. And it feels like a million years and lifetimes have passed since then, although it's been, I think, less than 2 years. But I really just am excited to catch up with you. So I thought a great place for us to start is you've had such an interesting trajectory in this field. I was wondering for any listeners who maybe might not be as familiar with your story, if you could just kind of walk us through, how did you get here and what has this journey looked like for you?
Well, that's a big question. And I always answer it slightly differently just because how we, you know, reflect on our story changes. And, you know, as I've said before, the further you go in your experience, the more it kind of recontextualizes your entire history. So I find that I'm seeing past events differently as time goes on. But to sort of mention some general highlights, speaking of being on Dreamland, one of the first highlights for me was reading the early Whitley Strieber books. And I was really, really taken with them. And I remember all of my friends kind of thought it was strange how I was so interested in this. I remember one time driving up to a mountain cabin, right? And this was bringing back memories of him talking about his cabin in upstate New York where so much happened. I was driving up to this cabin. And suddenly this huge light came through the trees. Turns out it was just the area where they store salt for the winter roads. And there's like a, you know, motion detector that came on. And so it flooded this light. But I immediately thought, you know, abduction, you know, we're in trouble. And all my friends just thought it was really strange. And then we went up to the cabin. And then one day we were playing poker one night, a bunch of us sitting around the table, and the wind blew open the front door. And it was a really interesting experience in people's different psychology, because everybody in the table kind of freaked out, but everybody had a different interpretation of what was about to come through the door. So somebody thought axe murder, somebody else thought a bear, and I'm like, gray aliens, you know? And so half of us were like moving away from the door, the other half were moving towards the door to try to slam it shut. So it was this really hilarious calamity. So I just remember being really fascinated by that at that age, sort of in my early 20s. And then also remembering having some really strange memory shards when I was really, really young, but those are so hard to place that I didn't really give them any thought. It's only more recently that I've kind of thought about them. And then the time that I had a really life-altering experience that changed my perspective of what can happen was in 2005. I was traveling with my young family across the country. At that time, I was moving from Tennessee to Washington State, and we were staying in a hotel. You've heard this story. Some other people have heard it. And in the early morning hours, I was awoken to find this humanoid female entity at the end of our bed. And initially, I thought sort of rationally, this must be our young, you know, three-year-old daughter getting up and maybe confused about where we are. But this being was too tall to be our daughter. And I kind of then realized this was something else. I got up out of bed and I moved towards this being. And as I moved towards the being, it, first of all, seemed surprised that I could see it or slash her. That's the impression I get when I think about the expression on the face that I saw. It was like surprised that I was awake or that I saw, like almost like I wasn't supposed to be seeing what I was seeing. And then she backed up towards the wall at the end of our bed and went right through the wall. And then I did a very strange thing at the time that made no sense to me. And I'm thankful for the lore to help explain later on to contextualize what this is about. I turned around and went right back to bed as if nothing strange had happened, which is not at all what someone would normally do. Now, what makes this event so different and so consequential in my history, and I feel so lucky about this, really privileged, is that my wife at the time saw the whole thing as well. So she was lying next to me in the bed. She had also woken up, saw the whole thing of me walking towards the entity going back through the wall. And then as I turned to come back to bed, I didn't see this because I'm looking towards the bed now. The entity came back through the wall. My wife saw this, came back through the wall, proceeded to walk down the front hallway in front of the two beds, right? Our bed was here and then our daughter's bed was next to it, and went right through the door. Like, didn't open the door, just went through the door. And then I tried to go back to sleep as if nothing had happened. And my wife shook me out of my stupor and said, "What are you doing going to sleep? We know what we both just saw." She was really confused about why I was trying to go to sleep. So I sort of, you know, shook out of that stupor. And then we talked about what we wanted to do, decided to get out of there. A key component, at least, can, you know, potentially, was that she was pregnant with our son at the time. I've often thought about that and what that might mean. Also, when we woke up our daughter, she had these strange welts all over her body, which again, could have just been something prosaic, like, you know, an allergic reaction to the sheets, although she'd never had that before, never had it since. We then decided to leave, get out of there quickly. On the road, within a couple of hours, those welts completely cleared up and she was fine. And initially, I didn't know what to do with that, right? As many people who've had these experiences will recall, that's, you just don't know what to do with it. I remember emailing people from the computer at the front of the hotel and explaining what happened to me. So family and friends, and almost everybody was like, "Yeah, that's weird. So what's with the weather like down there?" You know, like, it was just like quickly changing the subject. So I just put that in the back of my mind, like, didn't really give it much thought because it was so anomalous. Like, I just didn't know what to think about it. I didn't recognize the being, you know, looked mostly human. One of the interesting things is that it looked slightly different for my wife than it did for me. Just subtle differences. Like, she saw hair, like blonde hair blowing. Like, there was wind. I didn't see it blowing. It just was straight and falling to the sides of the head. And again, it was only later when I began to research the UFO lore that I realized, number one, often humanoid and human-looking beings are quite commonly encountered. Number two, there are subtle differences in what people perceive, which is really interesting. And you also notice this behavioral modification that seems to happen where people do things they wouldn't normally do. So suddenly, something that I either put in like the ghost category or something, turned into perhaps this was an example of the overarching phenomenon. And then, you know, just felt really, really drawn into the subject matter. And then started a podcast on the side, just thinking this will be something I do on the side while I continued my life as a software engineer. And initially, I was just known as Exoacademian with an alien avatar, so no one knew who I was. And then as time went on, that podcast kind of took off and I started getting invitations to retreats and conferences and things. And then you kind of had this moment where you're like, am I going to continue to like bring an alien mask and you know, disguise my voice, or am I going to actually show myself and sort of become more public? So I made the decision to become more public and I, you know, used a real picture of myself on social media and announced my name. And that was a chapter that even threw the doors open even wider and had even more experiences and opportunities arise. And one of the things that happened was I was invited to this private retreat at the Monroe Institute. And this was included people from sort of UFO history. So different people had been associated with the government before that had researched this topic. People who are researchers and people known as sort of prime contactees or really key experiencers or super experiencers, as my friend Sean Esborn Cargans would say. And we all came together and practiced a combination of CE5 and these various psi techniques all together kind of thing. So in the daytime, we would do psi stuff and of course retired to our bunks at the Monroe Institute, where you have a complete blackout situation and you have the out of body kind of techniques being broadcast through the speakers. And then we were also holding an intention for at night when we gathered in the meadow under the stars to make contact with benevolent beings. And on each of the nights that we did that, we did have encounters, and the whole thing was captured on really high quality cameras. We had people that came down from Canada to film the whole thing. We actually ended up submitting that footage to MUFON, and they confirmed that it was anomalous as far as they could tell. They didn't think it was anything prosaic that they could attribute it to. And most importantly for me was, it was right after that that I began to receive what I would call telepathic downloads that seemed related to that incident. I'd already had encounters, or not encounters, but strange notions come to me before then, and it felt associated, but it definitely ramped up after the experience of the Moreau Institute. And that really even inspires the material that I cover on the podcast, and the things I talk about feels very much like breadcrumbs are left for me along the trail, and I sort of follow this. So that is sort of what's happened since then. And then last year, another big change happened. I moved to my cabin here in Western North Carolina, very southwestern corner of the state, and was switching jobs at the moment. And that's when I was really thinking about making this a full-time gig. Right at that time, it turns out that the John Mack archives were in these boxes being shipped across the country in a U-Haul van, basically. And it turns out that the U-Haul van driver was a fan of my podcast and started playing back-to-back episodes for the entire trip from Cambridge down to Houston at the Rice Archives and Archives of the Impossible. And the executive director of the John Mack Institute, Karin Austin, heard it and really resonated with the way I spoke about and reflected the experience of the phenomenon. And as her being an experiencer, she really resonated with it. So then we started talking and really hit it off. And then I came on as the communications director and eventually became one of the development directors as well of the John Mack Institute. And all because of this little podcast that I started on the side years before.
Oh, that's so fascinating. I love how, and I think you and I have talked about this before, just the way that this sort of, like, once you start engaging with this work and in this field, there's this kind of synchronistic orchestration that takes over, and kind of, it feels like you're almost working in collaboration with something, and it puts various people in your field, in your path and that sort of thing. Like, what has that been like for you, the way that that's just continually unfolded?
Well, I mean, to put it frankly, it's completely changed my conception of reality, you know, is basically what I would say. I'm not exaggerating, and which is really interesting to live multiple decades and see the world in a certain way. Like I said, because of the experiences I'd had numerous anomalous experiences. That's just, I sort of mentioned a couple of the highlights that already had thrown up in my awareness that there's more going on than we are conventionally accounting for. But then after these events I just recounted, absolutely, it feels like a synchronistic orchestration. It feels very much like there's something moving through me and I'm responding to it and basically becoming a vehicle for it. I know that you just interviewed Bernardo recently, and I've spoken with Bernardo as well, and he would call this the daimon, you know, this impersonal or transpersonal force that moves through you. That's what it feels like. And I don't think this is separate from who I am, though. This is sort of a larger multidimensional kind of frame of who we are as beings. But as I sort of aligned with this, is what it really feels like, then this flow comes through. So it's like a small stream merging with a much more powerful river. And you're taken with the current. That's what it feels like. So much of what I do is more about tuning through meditation and whatnot to try to make sure I'm aligned with that, what it wants to do. And then I'm taken along for the journey. So much has happened since then, synchronistically, in terms of people I've connected with. Even things like, you know, they often say that at a certain point in life, it's difficult for people to make friends anymore. And they tend to just stay with the people they've already known. That has not been my experience at all. That in the last 3 years or so, all of the people closest to me in my life have been people I've met in that time frame and become really, really dear friends and people that you feel deeply connected to, almost like a strange memory from the future is what I call it, where you feel like somehow we knew each other somewhere else and somehow we have this vague sense that some part of us knew this was going to happen at this period in time. So it begins to change your understanding of space-time, the linear notion of events, all that kind of things. But yeah, absolutely. It's recontextualized everything and it only seems to keep ramping up.
Absolutely. I really identify with that. I've actually said that to a few of my like closer friends and collaborators in the field that getting to know them feels like remembering something more than it feels like getting to know someone, which is
exactly
a really interesting sensation. You take this really kind of broad view with your work, kind of an everything and the kitchen sink. And, you know, with your podcast Point of Convergence, kind of looking at all of these various aspects of the phenomenon and asking the larger questions about, you know, where is the point that they converge? Like, what is the underlying truth that's there? And so kind of from that perspective, as you've done this work, how has your understanding of what non-human intelligence is, like, how has that changed and evolved over time?
That's another huge question, but definitely worth diving into. It's interesting because, as you know, when we first dive into this field, we're confronted with the usual hypotheses, the usual players in terms of what, you know, is accounting for this. And it usually always begins for people with assuming these are, you know, straight extraterrestrials coming from Alpha Centauri, that kind of thing. It fits with our conventional notions of what the final frontier is based on what we think we know of the world now. And then, like Belay and John Keel and these different people have done such a great job of exposing, there's so much high strangeness and other elements that are so central to the encounters. They're not, you know, to the outside, they're not outliers. It's centrally connected to high strangeness. And because of that, you know, Belay kind of concluded that, you know, there's a much more interesting story here than can be accounted for with the extraterrestrial hypothesis alone, even though I think that is part of it. So then you start diving into other notions like cryptoterrestrials, ultra-terrestrials, interdimensionals. But even that usually is based around a physicalist notion of reality, where even an interdimensional is maybe a being coming from a parallel universe. And of course, this sort of conveniently and not, you know, understandably came about because at the time, science was beginning to conceive of reality that way. And so for people who, for instance, saw these beings popping in and popping out of our reality space, they thought, well, maybe they're coming in and going back to an alternate, you know, parallel universe, but still under a physicalist construct of the universe and of reality. And of course, then even with cryptoterrestrials / ultra-terrestrials, you suddenly realize there's a lot of the Earth we have not charted so well. And the oceans are really deep. And, you know, we have not explored very far beyond the crust of the Earth. And of course, when you add in the fact that a combination of either technology, high technology, or even consciousness manipulation, like what I experienced in the hotel where I did things I wouldn't normally do, you begin to realize maybe another sister species could be living here and we just don't know about it. So you begin to entertain that. But really, when you bring in, again, the high strangeness, you realize how general paranormality is all part of this. Near-death experiences are part of this, out-of-body experiences, you know, seeing apparitions, psi phenomena, right? The fact that in these stories, it's not just that the beings are telepathic, but that humans have the capacity to also telepathically communicate. And that furthermore, as you well know, the work of people like Dean Radin has made it clear that even human to human, we have these capacities, and almost every human has them. In fact, it's the exception to the rule to find someone who doesn't really have any experience with this. So when you begin to put all of that together, you start realizing that there's something about reality that we're not seeing. Hence, like you said, why I call it the point of convergence. What is this, you know, telling us about the nature of reality? And that to me is the most interesting question. That's really the question I'm most engaged in. I think that it even begins to, you know, that helped me stumble upon Bernardo's work, Bernardo Kastrup, the work of Donald Hoffman, just realizing that what we perceive of reality is just one small frame and may very well be a translation to an interface that doesn't have any kind of direct correlation with what's actually out there. So then it doesn't become a question of, for instance, why are we seeing them so rarely? Why are the pictures always blurry, et cetera, et cetera? How can this massive campaign that the abduction phenomenon would point to be going on if we don't have more direct evidence? Well, if we're only perceiving a small subset of reality, and even that is more like a translation to an interface, like a computer screen, then it's not at all surprising that that could happen without us being aware of it. So once you take into account what we perceive as such a small subset, and even then a translation from what's really there, a lot of this begins to make more sense. And, you know, Hoffman has made the point that the reason why the Fermi paradox exists is because, which speaks to the fact that it's strange we haven't found intelligent life through our usual means of looking for them with SETI and whatnot. The reason we haven't is because space-time is our evolutionarily derived headset that we're wearing and perceiving reality through, but they exist outside of that altogether. And he's even postulated that probably life, reality as it really is teeming with intelligences, but we only, again, see what is native to our evolutionarily derived headset. So then you end up, again, along the lines of Bernardo's work with something like idealism, realizing that all we really know is what we consciously perceive. Like, we cannot separate the world out there and even our measurement of it, our postulating about it, from our conscious experience of it. So then you start realizing maybe physical reality is just one modulation of numerous frames of reality. And, you know, I think Bernardo makes a great point, even in terms of, in his book, Meaning of an Absurdity, where he stresses that maybe the high strangeness is related to the fact that the symbolic aspects that we call highly strange and just weird might be, similar to the symbolic kind of dreams we sometimes have. So sometimes we have dreams that are full of symbolism, and sometimes we have dreams that seem quite literal. I've lucid dreamed and actually gone about trying to establish, does this feel as physical or less physical than my daily waking life? And I found that it's absolutely just as physical, right? I go around and I rub my hand against things. I smell things up close. I look really close, looking for some sort of glitch, right? But it's consistent and it's coherent. And so then you wake up in the morning and you go, how do I know this is any different than that? And then I sort of tie that with my background in Buddhism and ancient Vedantic thought and how they basically conceived of the world in those notions. So when you think about sort of the convergence, not just of the phenomena I just mentioned, but also ancient Vedantic thought with the latest revelations coming from quantum experiments, suddenly you realize this seems to be pointing in the same general direction, like signposts into a fog. We don't know exactly what's in there, but that to me seems like a more promising direction at this point.
I love that. Well, we're going to just take a quick commercial break and we'll be right back. Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasulka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. So much of the challenge of really understanding the phenomenon is that we're caught in this place where so much of what we're relying on in terms of data is these very like kind of subjective experiences. And we're trying to then extrapolate this more objective scientific understanding of what our reality is and what exactly is going on here. I think you do a really good job of threading that needle. So what advice do you have for people who are maybe newer to this subject, who are struggling with the nuts and bolts versus the high strangeness? Like, how can people begin to synthesize these things and plot a way forward?
Yeah, it's a great question. I'm mindful of that because so many new people are coming into the fold because we're in the midst of this disclosure push. Yeah, absolutely. And when you and I reflect on when we first came in and the journey we went through, realizing that, you know, you almost like to need to set up a syllabus for people to have a soft landing, because it it does so much, hence the name of your particular podcast, right? It's the deepest of rabbit holes. It goes in so many different directions. I think that I would point out a couple of things. Number one, when we are considering intelligences, they're so much more sophisticated than us. We should not be surprised, not only that they can run circles around our technology, but their technology operates in such a way that we don't even necessarily perceive it as technology. We might not even be able to perceive it at all. And when you take into consideration things like precognitive sentient phenomena, right, which was a term John Alexander coined to discuss what they saw at Skinwalker Ranch, where even when they tried to measure things, they found that something, some intelligence was always one step ahead of them, knew what they were going to do, and at the last minute, the camera would shut down or would malfunction so that they could never actually get solid data, right, to hand over to scientists and whatnot. So the first thing to remember, and this is often not considered enough in my opinion, is that if these really are hyper-sophisticated intelligences, then their technology is going to be able to take into account how we would measure, and they will only let it measure when they want it to be, you know, measured. So that's important to think about. We're used to being the apex intelligence, and we just go about looking at nature and conducting measurements, and we assume we'll have consistent data to deal with as a result. But if we're talking about intelligences higher than us, more advanced than us, then suddenly it becomes quite simple for them to manipulate the entire situation. I would also say, I don't think people should assume that means nefarious intent. I just think it means that we need to sort of be humble about where we are on the pyramid kind of thing. I would also say that that technology also stretches into mind itself, getting back to our notions of idealism, that they seem to be able to not just manipulate the physical environment and the kind of test apparatus that we might set up, but they can also manipulate our perception. And that if they, for instance, know that space-time is the way that we perceive the world, they could control that in such a way that they can hand us whatever custom reality they want us to see at a particular time, which helps to explain why sometimes you'll have these cases like Jacques Vallée has, you know, uncovered, where people are driving down a busy road where there's people everywhere driving, and they'll notice a giant UFO. They'll take video footage of it. And what's interesting is clearly the other people on the road are not seeing the UFO while they in the car are. But even furthermore, that what ends up being on the footage is different than what they saw in real time. So you've got sort of three different layers of reality being delivered to people on the scene in real time. So that gives you a hint of how much control they have, how much control they wield over our perception. And then I think also you have to consider, you know, intent, like what is ongoing here? Like, what are they trying to do? And then I think about Vallée's notion of the control system, the notion that perhaps what they're trying to do is deliberately stay on the fringes of our awareness so they can still inject almost like on a quantum level with this like hyper measurement, know exactly how little they need to do to move our civilization in one direction or another, but to be able to do it on the fringes so we're never aware that we're being steered that way. So that would actually explain why the images are so blurry, as the, you know, the skeptics always complain and whatnot, and that so much of this is anecdotal, because they don't want to be directly seen or perceived. There may be some degree of a prime directive there about not wanting us to take into account that we are being steered, but they still want to be able to steer us. So this then gets into really, really consequential questions around our origins, around the idea of augmentation of humanity over time. How we, even as a species, might have different origins in terms of our genetic mix from different star people, right? There's a lot of evidence of that, for instance, in Artie Sixclitter-Clark's work and her work in taking accounts from different indigenous tribes around the world, not just in terms of their most recent experiences, but even the lore they have about where they came from and who they are. So when you start thinking about this, you realize that you started with nuts and bolts technology, thinking this is cool tech from Alpha Centauri, from some ETs, to suddenly realizing everything about reality and our origins and our destiny all come into play together. Because, for instance, one of the things I think is the most consequential matters to consider is the convergence of events going on around us right now. We talked before about convergence of these different phenomena, but the rise of AI, the geopolitical strife we see in the world, this move towards some sort of acknowledgement or disclosure. And sometimes these hints from people that are former, you know, intelligence insiders like John Ramirez saying that some event is coming, that some people in the intelligence community know some event is coming to do with a major revelation around some of these beings. How is this all connected, right? Especially when you even, for instance, this upcoming week, I'm going to do a podcast episode for POC on ancient religious tradition and how what might be recorded there is not origins, but regenerations after cataclysms, right? It's not the beginning of humanity, but the rebooting of humanity, along with the steering and direction and sometimes augmentation of these other beings. So this is how big it gets once you start down that nuts and bolts path.
It's crazy. It's a slippery slope, right? You end up in places you never thought you would. Diving into something you just said that I find really interesting, and I think it's something we don't talk about enough, is talking about the kind of level of control that whatever this non-human intelligence presence seems to have over our perception and the direction that we potentially even take as a species. How do you think about that in terms of disclosure? Because it seems like we talk about these different, you know, warring factions behind the scenes who are pushing for transparency, but we don't often talk about the role that the non-human intelligence is almost certainly playing in the events that are unfolding. So how do you think through all of that?
Yeah, it's a great point, and it's absolutely pertinent to this. And it is strange. It's like the pink elephant in the room that everybody talks about it, but it's right there and we're not like acknowledging that it's still doing things right now. Absolutely. I think that one thing I'm pretty clear on is that nothing really happens without these overarching intelligences wanting it to happen because of things like memory control that's so central to the experience of experiencers that, you know, they can wipe memories, they can use screen memories to cover over other memories. Even when it comes to the abduction phenomenon, an open question, as you well know, is just how many people have had contact and just don't remember it, right? It might be the anomaly that people will remember for all we know. And even when you do start to add up the numbers of people who have come forward with these experiences, knowing that they're already the minority, most people don't come forward even today. So when you start adding up the numbers internationally, it's huge. I think for me, what's also interesting is part of my journey has involved, like I say, these direct downloads where I get a sense of things. There are times where I can like posit a question to the field and get an answer, sometimes overnight, sometimes immediately. Sometimes I get the question at the exact same, the answer to the question at the exact same moment I ask it, and it happens so quickly that I don't even, is that the answer? That's what happens to me sometimes. And that's been a really, really bizarre experience. I also have many friends and colleagues who are experiencers, and we compare notes. And I almost need like a giant like white wall that I can like write on and try to connect the dots, because I'm constantly trying to amass this data to try to get a sense of what is happening in the larger scope. And of course, it's also complicated by the fact that there are different groups, perhaps even with different origins. That's the first thing I'd point out, is that as humans, and Bernardo does a great job of pointing this out, we want to collapse complexity. We want to reduce. We want to simplify. We want closure. So we want a simple answer and say, it's this, and this is what they're doing. But it's so much more complex than that when you look closely. And I think we actually confuse the matter because we do try to collapse and conflate these different origins and different agendas. And then it looks really confusing because sometimes one will conflict with another. In this upcoming episode on Point of Convergence, I'm going to cover how even the terms used for God and gods in the Old Testament, in the Torah, actually changed in the Hebrew. And then later on, when that material was edited to fit with a certain theological persuasion, a lot of times those terms were just collapsed into each other to sort of imply that one God is acting through time, when actually the original text seems to suggest something else, that there was actually a crowd of different beings with different agendas pulling and pushing humanity in different ways, which is really interesting. So I think that's still happening today. And part of the information I amass from friends and colleagues and my own downloads is a sense of what some of those agendas are, and sometimes how there's differences of opinion even around what is the best way forward for humanity. And part of the reason why disclosure is so difficult to pin down is because, as you sort of hint there, there's not just different human groups, some that want it, some that don't, some on the inside who are ready to finally come clean, some who absolutely don't want to come clean. There's the matter of like criminal activity that's been part of the cover-up that doesn't want to get exposed. and the fact that our entire understanding of 20th century American history, not to mention human history, changes as a result. So this is so consequential that it becomes this real, you know, perplexing question. How exactly do you begin to disclose that in a way that doesn't completely destabilize modern civilization? But yes, I think when I think about the different agendas, different goals for humanity, one of the things I'm pretty clear on that I try to make this point, especially in our UFO community, because often again, in that reduction to simplicity, people talk about these beings as if they're one kind of being with one agenda, one level of consciousness. So for me, part of my background in integral theory and spiral dynamics is understanding the spectrum of consciousness development that humans go through over time, that's predictable, that's seen in the data across cultures, where if you look at a certain culture, you take the sort of temperature on their current stage of consciousness, and unless there's some sort of major calamity, you can predict where they're going next. And that's true for human beings too. There's these predictive ways you can see this march of consciousness towards larger and larger spheres of care and concern, that this is actually sort of seems to be like consciousness is like a weighted table in the cosmos, in the sense that it's weighted towards greater and greater spheres of understanding, belonging, identity, those kinds of things. We see how human beings have gone from, you know, tribal kind of mentality to nation state, maybe religious identity, to then seeing themselves as global citizens, and eventually this kind of cosmocentric awareness. So we see this expansion. I think that's a constant that happens for all these different kinds of intelligences. But because of that, we shouldn't make the mistake of thinking that just because they have more advanced technology than us, that all of them are necessarily ahead of us in a moral kind of development, right? I think that's a mistake. And I think what we see is actually quite a range in their own consciousness development based on the actions we see. So in that sense, when you think about all of these different forces, human and non-human, that are have a say in what happens to our civilization, it gets really complex. And I think when you think like on a quantum level, like each one of those conscious inputs is a micro fluctuation in the probability cloud of what will happen in our future, it becomes very difficult to predict because there's so many forces pushing and pulling in different directions. But absolutely, we have to think about what they're wanting and be honest with ourselves that whatever happens only happens when they say that's what they want to happen.
Absolutely. As you've mentioned a little bit here and there in this conversation, and you definitely talk about on your podcast, contact and contact work has been a part of your journey and a big part of, you know, the research that you do. I see, you know, in my UFO rabbit hole world, I get a lot of people who are kind of like newer to the subject. And one of the first places that they want to go, I think either to kind of get some sort of a confirmation or to just sort of explore things more deeply is into contact work. And so I was wondering if you could give kind of some advice and lessons learned maybe for people who are interested in getting into that kind of thing. And, you know, what should they expect and what should they look out for? And how can they do this in a way that's going to be positive for them?
Yeah, it's a great question. Yeah, there's definitely things I would recommend and some things I would not recommend. I think that one thing that becomes clear, has become clear in my research, is that there's a certain reflective aspect to this contact work, in the sense that the energy you're sort of emitting to the cosmos, consciously or not, when you reach out to make contact, often gets reflected back to you. That's become one of the notions about Skinwalker Ranch, right? If you have a military branch that goes in with kind of this adversarial kind of approach, how much are they seeing reflected back to them, that same kind of mentality? Either for a purpose, or maybe that's just some instinctual thing that's built in to happen. But when it comes to contact work, like we think about CE5 or heists, you know, human initiated contact experience or events, that's a pretty well documented and established kind of protocol. And people around the country and to some degree around the world can look to find local chapters of different CE5 groups. I know there's one in Asheville near where I live. And basically the notion there is that you set a positive intention to make contact with a specific kind of entity. So you don't just say, hey, whatever's out there, come say hi. That's not what you do, right? You sort of, you first of all want to resonate this vibration of positivity, benevolence, connectivity, harmony, those kinds of things. You don't want to be radiating fear, you know, judgment, those kinds of things, because that can get reflected back. Because you're sort of sending out a signature that gets recognized and echoed back is the way that I would describe it. So not only do you need to send out a positive one if you want to have a positive encounter, but if you're not yet really acquainted with what it, like self-conscious or self-aware about what energy you are emitting, I would say take some time to work on that first. If you are a very fearful person, then I would say maybe doing this is not the best first step, like work on some of that internal transmutation of energy before you try that. But when you do it, you gather with people. You could do it alone, but often it's a good idea to do it with people at first that are more experienced. Again, you have this positive intention to make contact with positive, benevolent beings who see you as kind of brothers and sisters. And you can do that with CE5. And often, again, like what happened to me at the Monroe Institute, has happened to me a couple other times too, often we will not just see lights in the sky, phenomena in the sky, but there will often be messages that are related to it as well. And many, many people who've never seen an alien up close, example of non-human intelligence, still can have their mentality shifted, even their worldview opened up based on just sightings and the telepathic contact, the lock that forms. So I would recommend people do that. I also think that for me, what's been one of the most profound methods is just meditation. We could describe it like our conscious waking state is more like the islands that are poking above the water across the surface of the planet. But actually that below the surface, that connects to the substructure below the ocean, to the earth itself. And that's true for us as well, that we actually have the capacity to reach these much deeper, more profound levels. And this is as much about a journey of going within as it is about going without and exploring the cosmos, that you kind of get to the same place as either way, which is really interesting, especially in terms of an idealism kind of view of the world. So through meditation, you can also sort of transcend that narrow frame that maybe evolution has served up for us and begin to experience these broader frames. So it can happen through CE5, a protocol with people. It can happen through meditation. It can happen even through psychedelics, right? That's one of the most interesting notions, is that people find that they experience consistent entities, not only when they have different experiences over time. Sometimes it could be 5 years between times, and they meet up with the same beings that remember them from before and carry on a conversation like no time has passed. But we also find a consistent description of these beings by different people who don't know each other who encounter them, which suggests some sort of independent ontology to them. So there's, I think, many, many different kinds of beings. And it's not just about outer space or Earth. It's about, this much broader context of what is available in these sort of interlocking dreamscapes or interpenetrating dreamscapes. And we can sort of drop into these, pass through the porous membrane of these frames and experience these beings. And it seems to happen, beyond space and time, which I think does support the notion that space-time is just one way of experiencing things in a certain kind of frame. For instance, when people sometimes call out for a sighting through CU5, they might perceive that this craft or something is out by Neptune, and yet instantaneously they see the craft, right? So then it provokes really interesting questions. Was the craft there all along, just waiting for you, or maybe inspiring you to ask for this call and response? Or did it, with no time at all, travel the expanse of space so it could be there for you? I think it's something beyond space-time altogether. So we see evidence of this. So absolutely, I would say to people, begin to experiment. But again, be cognizant of your energy. Maybe join with others first and begin to understand how it works. I know that some CE5 groups will even invite newcomers to come and have dinner with them first, hang out over coffee, get to know each other. Because you do want to cultivate this coherent field of intention where you're not actually pulling each other in different directions energetically. So sometimes it's good to get to know a newcomer first, make sure they understand the vibration you're trying to put forward in these experiences, make sure that everybody's on the same page before you do that. So I think these are things to be aware of. Like, don't be afraid of it, but do be cognizant about how you go about it.
That's great advice. And on that note, we're going to take a quick commercial break.
My new book, Them, has now been out since March of 2023. I would like to thank everyone for the wonderful reception, those who have read it, who have posted thoughtful reviews on Amazon, those who have listened. It's an important book for me, and also over the months, it has become a very strange book, because if you listen to the Oversight Committee UAP hearings, you will hear David Grusch saying things that almost sound like they were taken right out of the second part of them. And I thought to myself, how did I do that? The answer is, I have no idea. But the book is really very prophetic. And I think you should read it if you hadn't done so. And that's what this is all about. Read it, listen to it. It's really worth your time. Jacques Vallée certainly thought so. Mitch Horowitz thought so. Jeff Kripal thought so. Leslie Kane, Diana Pasolka, and all of the others who gave it blurbs thought so. And so do an awful lot of people who have reviewed it. So pick up a copy today. Go to Amazon and get a copy. Go to Audible and get the audio book. Listen to them. Read them. It's a whole new vision of how we should think about the close encounter experience. And this is getting more and more important over time. More and more important. Them. I saw the future when I was writing that book. Didn't know I would, but I did. You can read it now and see for yourself.
Hi, everyone. This is Kelly Chase. I'm Dreamland's new monthly guest host. You can catch me here on the last Friday of every month. If you're interested in checking out my other work, you can find that on my podcast, The UFO Rabbit Hole. On that show, I share my own personal research with deep dives into everything from historical cases to philosophical frameworks, as well as in-depth interviews with top thinkers in the field, like Jeffrey Kripal, Diana Walsh-Pasolka, Bernardo Kastrup, James Madden, and of course, Dreamland's own Whitley Strieber. You can find the UFO Rabbit Hole on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever else you listen to podcasts. Just search for the UFO Rabbit Hole. And if you like what you hear and you want to go even further down the rabbit hole with me, I'd like to invite you to join my Patreon community. Patrons get perks like early access to new content and ad-free episodes. I host twice monthly patron-only Zoom calls where you can ask me questions, share your own thoughts, and connect with others. We also have a lively and active private Discord server where members host book clubs, happy hours, and just share their thoughts on all things anomalous without all the drama that's all too common on social media. It's a warm, open-minded, and vibrant community, and we'd love to have you join us. Memberships start at just $5 a month. You can sign up at patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. That's patreon.com/UFO rabbit hole. There's been a lot of talk over the last few years about the future human hypothesis. And I know that, you know, you on your show often talk about not just non-human intelligences, but non-conventionally human intelligences. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the evidence that we have that at least part of the phenomenon might be some version of us in some way and what that implies about humanity.
Yeah, for sure. And I think what's interesting about this is that often, again, we should watch out for our biases, right, with this field. And because this is a field only just beginning to be taken seriously in academia, a lot of people in the field kind of pick their, you know, pet theory or hypothesis and run with it and sometimes ignore data that's staring them in the face they just don't find convenient. And to that point, a lot of people don't want to make note of negative abductions or negative experiences that at least seem to challenge our notion of just benevolent aliens being involved. And what's interesting there is people assume that the aliens would be so much more benevolent than us, that they hope that maybe this kind of divisive kind of nature and adversarial nature is more something unique to humans. I already made the point that I don't think that's the case. I think the spectrum of consciousness development happens across the sort of cosmic landscape. But what's interesting, if you start thinking about some of these might be us from the future, then you suddenly go, well, then it's not so hard to imagine that they might have mixed motives and they might put their own interests above ours because we see each other doing that to each other. So that's the first thing that comes up is that, again, when you don't conflate and assume this is all one thing, then you begin to try to look for patterns, like micro patterns within the overarching pattern. And I think, you know, that Mike Masters, a friend of mine, has done brilliant work in elucidating how strong the evidence is for that hypothesis, because, you know, where most of us looked at the front cover of Whitley's communion book when it first came out and said, oh, scary, alien. Mike looked at it and said, that looks like something related to humankind, which is really interesting in itself, right? In terms of, again, sometimes the initial thoughts that come to us, the initial conceptions might not just be our own. I'll just say that. I think that might have been happening with Mike there, because it's a very unique understanding. Of course, this influenced him in some way to go on and, you know, study anthropology and specifically the branch of anthropology that made him an expert in this and in the hominid line and understanding how the evolutionary process has worked for the hominid line. And with that expertise, he looks at the typical quintessential gray alien and says, this being must almost certainly be related to us somehow. And furthermore, makes the point that if you just take the current trends that we're seeing already march along in terms of human evolution, and you know, imagine where that's going to be in 10,000 years, it might look exactly like something like a gray alien. The more childlike faces that we're developing, the larger eyes, right? The larger brain, these kinds of things are already, we're seeing those trends in human development. So when you sort of walk that out, then eventually you could see something like a gray alien coming to being, especially when you factor in something like some sort of cataclysm that perhaps blocks the light of the sun, creating beings that have to have much larger eyes, humans that have to have much larger eyes, be able to see, right? The skin might become much more pale and gray because, again, there's less sunlight coming through, or perhaps they even have to descend into the recesses of the earth for a while to survive nuclear winter or something like that, right? So when you think about, again, notions that might arise in our future that are not hard to imagine, that you could look at the confluence of forces converging right now and say, one day something like that, whether it's a comet, you know, coming and hitting the earth, which there's evidence that's happened before, I think about the dinosaurs, or some sort of nuclear winter event. When you, again, tie together events that might very well lie in our future with the fact that they look so humanoid and human, really, basically, right? Because the real kicker here is that you ask yourself, why would an alien being supposedly arising on a different planet with completely different environmental constraints end up looking anything like a humanoid, let alone, you know, so much like a human? Two eyes, you know, two semblance of an ear, right? The slit of what looks to be maybe a mouth. You think about the fact that they become telepathic. Maybe they are, again, us in the future with a more advanced capacity for telepathic communication, at which point, you know, a mouth becomes superfluous because they also, as the lore goes, sometimes can consume nutrients through their skin directly. So suddenly you think about a mouth, which we use for speaking and eating. If those things are not necessary, then according to the theory of evolution, eventually those traits would drop away. And maybe that's why we see just a slit of, like, the hint of a memory of a mouth. So when you add up all that data, the fact that they look so humanoid, that we're interacting with them on the earth, the fact that they often tell us that they are us from the future, right? There was recently someone on social media who started talking about an experience he had as a 10-year-old. And he's kind of like, you know, drew up enough courage, because he was one of the abductees in the 90s. There was a big move of abduction that happened in the 1990s. There is a historicity to this. It's not the same across time. It's not, you know, uniform that way. There definitely was a historical operation of abduction and hybridization experiments, which happened towards the end of the 20th century, which doesn't mean they're not happening now, but the bulk of that happened as one particular historical enterprise. So he was one of these people. And when he one day got the courage to say, so are you guys aliens? The being paused and said, I can understand why you would think that, but no, we're actually you from the future. But then he went on to say, but we now live on a different planet. And so in that sense, they're both extraterrestrial and human, right? Or extratempestrial, neo-human is what I like to call them. And then he asked a further question. So therefore, are all aliens us from the future? And he said, no, there's different kinds of beings interacting with modern Homo sapiens sapiens. We're just one form. So I think this anecdotal evidence, when taken in total, begins to build this picture that this is actually a complex array of beings from different origin sources interacting with us. One of which definitely seems to be, I think, the, you could argue based on the data, is us from the future.
It's so fascinating to me that, you know, people come into this field with the question of like, who are these non-human intelligences and what is the the origin of the UFO phenomenon? And then we end up getting back to questions about who we are, because it seems like the implications about what humanity is and where it's heading are potentially really profound. I mean, even just the fact that psi phenomena exist, the fact that we have the capacity to, you know, have some measure of contact with non-human intelligences. How has that influenced your thinking? And like, are you beginning to see the human race differently?
Yeah, this is one of the most consequential matters, and in some ways, the most controversial in terms of conventional thinking and what would fly in modern society, because I think that really interesting wrinkles begin to emerge. One of them that I hinted at earlier is that we may not have a single origin, like the conventional story tells us. We may actually be a complex mix of different kinds of beings. We may find that we actually have some of the same genetic building blocks as some of these beings. As you most likely know, John Ramirez and amongst others have said that part of the revelation coming out of Roswell is that the beings recovered were not just space aliens, that perhaps humankind could have accepted that, but they had some sort of genetic similarity to us that suggested some sort of common origin or some sort of descent from them. So that was considered just too much for human civilization to grok at the time. And so that, he would suggest, is why there's been this cover-up. I think it's complex also because not only do we have this notion of our genetic background might be, first of all, originated from them. There's definitely a notion amongst the greys, for instance, that they like to play this genetic game. They are constantly splicing together different kinds of DNA from different beings. And the hybridization program, from the data I've seen, strongly suggests that they are basically seeing it as an experiment in many different directions. And that part of the lore that comes out of that is that some of the earlier experiments were not so successful, that they're desire to hybridize a human being and a gray alien didn't work so well, that they go through a process of perfecting the matter. And again, according to that historical enterprise that I referred to in the 20th century, that they largely had perfected it and gathered what they needed in terms of the hybridization results by the end of around the 20th century. So that, of course, raises really interesting questions about where we came from and are we all the same? So again, there is definitely hints in the data that different indigenous groups, different people with perhaps even different biomarkers actually have different capacities that might be related to these different origin sources. So I think that's going to be one of the most consequential things and controversial things to arise in terms of opening up a Pandora's box alone. And then furthermore, on top of that, I think that we are multidimensional beings ourselves. I think that the same way I use that analogy of the island poking above the water is just our usual conscious experience, but we're actually connected to everything, which means to everyone and everything eventually. And so where you posit the I in that really changes depending on how big the context is. That's one of the revelations, again, of ancient spiritual cosmologies, right? And ancient Eastern traditions around the single small self is largely illusory. And then some of these practices like meditation expose that reality to you. And it changes how you think about yourself. And again, what's fascinating is that many people have had these encounters with these beings come back with that same revelation that I don't die. I'm an eternal being. I'm connected to these beings. Many of the people I know that were abductees from the 90s begin to recognize that they themselves are hybrid beings of a sort, and even take on a different kind of mentality when with the beings than they do when they're in their usual earthly form. So it just gets more and more complex, even when it comes to, again, really tuning into what you feel called to in life. Again, I think you can begin to look at like small self Darren in this body mind is the vehicle of expression for a larger source, a higher self that wants to move in a certain way. And so I want to tune myself to that. I want to channel with that. And then express that. And that's when I feel that flow state. That's when I feel like I'm really living the life I was designed to live. But it's as much about aligning with a higher self as it is about just tuning into that in my brain or something like that. So this is how complex how broad-reaching this question of who we are. I think that will be definitely one of the most interesting questions that arise out of this, is that we will go from focusing on them from a kind of like fear response, like what are they, what do they want, to suddenly going, wait a second, then who are we and what does this mean, and what is reality? Like all of these questions sort of like emerge from each other.
That's amazing. I know now you're giving, you're doing classes about consciousness and expanding consciousness, and that sort of thing. I was lucky enough to be one of your guinea pigs in one of your earliest iterations, and it was really a life-changing experience for me in so many ways. So I've been really excited to see that you've continued on with that work. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about, you know, what your kind of purpose is behind those classes. Like, what are you teaching people? And how do you see that impacting people, and how does it affect their lives as they move forward?
Right. I remember fondly that small group of four people that you were a part of. That was great. That was definitely the first guinea pig experiment. And it was so exciting and profound. And it connected us all in such a deep way that it really made me want to do more of that. So I remember you being appreciative and encouraging me to carry on that path. So I have. So thank you for that. So what comes out of this, like I say, is a profoundly different sense of who I am, right? So therefore who we all are. And yet we're walking around under the illusion that we're these little units of consciousness that stick around for 8 or 9 decades, if we're lucky, and then it's all over. And according to modern science, there's nothing left of us. And what became of us was kind of like a fluke of nature anyway, when matter happened to cohere in a certain way and give this strange secondary response of something thinking it's conscious, right? And first of all, think about what that does to the human psyche in general, being told that life is meaningless, purposeless, and that there's no sense behind it at all, which is kind of what we're taught in modern society, and then asked to go along and become productive members of society while we live with that reality. So one thing, again, that becomes clear from ancient Vedantic thought, you know, that's common to many of the world religions, is also something that arises in the experiences people have with these beings, where they realize they, first of all, are eternal beings, having a particular experience in one particular form, being the human incarnation. And that alone changes so much. When you think about the really compelling research coming out of near-death experiences that make it so clear, even when you think about, there have been some university studies where they will track down these kids who for the first years of their life have a really profound sense of someone else they were before. And that, you know, that begins to, as the child forms more of an ego, an executive ego, that begins to dissolve and they identify around the new sense of who they are. But for those first few years, we find really compelling examples of kids who remember being another person in an earlier life. And these researchers from universities, like Western University, have been able to track down these originating families. And the information the kid has is so compelling, and it's not public, that often these families from the original family are able to confirm there's no way he could have known this unless he's tapping either into some cosmic Akashic record that we all have access to, or that some part of him is really remembering a previous life. So same thing again with these encounters that suddenly people can have, for instance, like their energy, their consciousness energy drawn out from their body. They can look back at their body, see their body, and here they are as this ball of energy, which is similar to an out-of-body experience, where you come out of the body and suddenly you realize, I am not my physical body, as I'm not only my physical body, as Bob Monroe would say. So all of this is pointing to something really profound about who we are. And then you begin to ask questions about, like, what am I here for? You know, what is this all about? And I also look at the considerable problems we're facing in the world. I mentioned earlier this convergence of forces, the rise of artificial intelligence. Rather than stopping and sort of calling a tribal council and saying, let's think about how to use this for the best intention of all of humanity and the planet and the animal species. Instead, we're competing with each other, racing at breakneck speed to see who can get to AGI first. And it looks like a Terminator scenario potentially, right? Because we're just giving so little forethought to it. And we still are motivated by notions of scarcity and competition. So all of that arises both individually, seeing myself as a little self who's separate from everybody else and the planet and the cosmos, and the fact that we perceive scarcity in our space on the planet and compete with each other, all of that arises from a misunderstanding of who we are fundamentally. So in that sense, all problems, whether individual or collective, arise from this consciousness issue, that when we see ourselves in the correct context, these things begin to solve themselves. A lot of the problems just dissolve into nothingness because they're based on an illusion to begin with. So what I felt really, really called to with Essence of Being is to help people come into contact experientially with that broader part of themselves. So it's a combination of practices like group meditation we do, giving people things they do during the week in between the meetings or the classes, and curriculum that's designed to help people expand their awareness, expand their sense of who they are and who we are, and help them realize that in that transformation comes the resolution of all of our problems globally. And I really feel like we need that change. We need that sort of massive transformation, because if we continue on the course we're on, which of course is exactly what so many of these beings have been saying, you think back about the kids in Zimbabwe and the encounter they had. So many of the friends of mine in the 90s that were abductees told the same thing. If humanity continues on this course, you know, a bad result awaits you. So even when some of these cases that we think of historically, one of the most common things these beings say is you've lost sight of who you truly are. And that saddens these beings often. So that's what my classes are primarily about, is because I've been so inspired by that much broader sense of who I am and how we're connected to each other. I'm aiming to help other people have that same experience, so collectively we can, you know, change the trajectory of the ship, basically.
Well, that's amazing. And I've heard from so many people who've taken your class who are absolutely loving it. So I'm so happy to see you really settling into that. And on that note, we're going to leave behind our free listeners of Dreamland and move on. So farewell to everyone. For paid members, Darren and I are going to be continuing our conversation, talking about his work at the John E. Mack Institute and along with Dr. Mack's legacy and a bunch of other interesting things over there. If you're not a paid member, you can sign up on unknowncountry.com.
You've been listening to Dreamland. Be sure to tune in again next week. Dreamland is brought to you by unknowncountry.com and its family of subscribers. Our theme music is The O of Pleasure by Ray Lynch. Unknown Country was founded by Ann Strieber. Our news editor is Matthew Frizzell. Our coordinator is Amy Safrankova. Whitley Strieber is your Dreamland host. And I'm your announcer, Ted Alexander.